Hello, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Williamson, and I'm a visual artist and brain researcher. And I'm also currently an undergraduate senior at Arizona State University and a current medical school applicant. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about COVID-19 and sort of how that's shaped the context of consciousness uploading technology. And I'll be discussing consciousness in different ways using my art. So I want to go ahead and explain this one a little bit. So I sort of drew this as a mirror image where I have my demon character at the bottom who's inspired by coronavirus, the novel coronavirus. And I have this superhuman character at the top. She's one of my original characters. And so she's actually in this artwork, she's already in that superhuman form, sort of already in, she's been through that process of consciousness uploading technology. And something that I didn't really do in this piece as much was do consciousness imagery, and she's more, herself is more her biological form. But I think it's very interesting to discuss if consciousness is actually a physical concept or not, which I will get into a little bit later. And let me stop sharing so I can show you the next artwork. And yeah, so, and in this other artwork, I did consider that consciousness is very complex and there's so many different aspects, but this was more imaginative in the sense that we have more of that non-physical consciousness imagery, but I also made up different kinds of neurons. So we have, you know, your typical neuron, and then there's different neurons which contribute to different levels of consciousness. In my research, though, it's kind of similar, but I was inspired by Dr. Hameroff and Sir Penrose to write more about microtubules and their associated proteins in neurons. And there's definitely a very complex physical framework for consciousness, and it makes me think that while there is a quantum aspect, there also is that, like, we have quasi-crystals, as Sir Penrose kind of talked about before. There's also a non-quantum level, and those microtubules sort of form their own kind of geometry in a way. And, you know, even the proteins in there, you know, and then enzymes in general, they all have this kind of geometry, even though it's not based on the lock and key model. There's just this geometry that sort of, it creates a way for electrical signaling and all these other related functions to work. So I do believe there needs to be some kind of combination of, or quantum processes must be related to these non-quantum ones, because there is some purpose to having a macro level of biology, I believe. So I'm still researching that. And again, so I will stop sharing. And I want to share also in another view of consciousness. So I used to be very interested, or I had my own concept about something called a DNA suit. And this was very interesting because it was about kind of using, being able to transform anything into the DNA of a person, something like that. It's been a while since I looked at that thing that I made up many, many years ago. But in this artwork, I tried to bring that back in the sense that we have the brain and the spinal cord as sort of there's sort of that DNA imagery, and that's showing that the spinal cord and the brain, those are, you know, part of consciousness. That's what holds the self, and the other parts are just, the self can kind of be reimagined in this suit that transforms things, but it's really about the brain and the spinal cord. And I think something that's very interesting is that if we look at, there's been recent news about the head transplant, and of course that's, as far as I know, that's not something that's been successfully done, or if it has, there's been reports of it being sort of quite a scary idea. So, and I mean, even I can see how if the brain was cut from the spinal cord, we might want to ask, are neurons not part of consciousness? Because if you cut off the spinal cord, there are still, you know, that's still part of the nervous system. So in the brain, are the neurons also, you know, not part of consciousness themselves, or more of that framework? Okay, and then, so I do want to move on to the next one. And this is more, I was considering consciousness more in sort of a metaphysical sense, because there's very, and I'll leave this one. You can read the description if you want to as well on my webpage for this artwork. I will leave my contact information at the end of the presentation. But, and there's a lot to unpack, but I wanted to mention how this kind of ties into consciousness as represented in Taoism. It's a very interesting Chinese religion, and consciousness in that religion is, I guess they don't really talk about the word consciousness, and of course it is, I can see how it is a vague term, but they do talk about energy, which is, you know, not, it's kind of physical matter, and it's energy that's present in spirits of the body, from what I've read. And that concept is, the concept is that you need to kind of manipulate energy and move it around. You need to work to keep that energy and, you know, be careful not to lose it by doing careless activities. And that's kind of, it reminds me of physical matter when we talk about, you know, some more scientific concepts, and how consciousness is sort of this energy, or we need energy to survive, and we need to go through this cycle of using and moving energy in these systems. The systems aren't just static, so. And of course, there's some other interesting, there's so much interesting things to talk about. But Tao is sort of, in Taoism, it's this one common consciousness. And it is really interesting to think about whether consciousness is something that dissipates, or something that, you know, it's, what, could that exist on its own? If it's non-physical, then what kind of consequences would that have for medical resource allocation and the economic side of preserving consciousness? Because perhaps if we don't need, you know, these technological advancements, how would that affect how accessible it would be? And then, so I kind of touched upon this in another artwork. And here we go. Let me just share that. So this is the artwork where the consciousness is sort of, it's this very surreal concept. And of course you can view, I actually have more artworks that have this surreal kind of flowing consciousness, but I think it's very intriguing to consider that maybe consciousness can still be preserved in a more non-physical way. But I also think if we look at it as maybe like in Taoism being partially non-physical, but also integrated with biology, you know, is that something like computronium, where when I think of that, when I think of computronium, I think of, oh, can we manipulate matter to the ways we want? And can we manipulate consciousness like it's energy? Is that something that can be molded? So I kind of like to make artworks about this consciousness as still a representation of the self that can be somewhat preserved in a way. But we don't really know what the truth about consciousness is yet. But I think, well, that's really about it. There's so much more to talk about, but feel free to send me questions through email. Here is my contact info. I will share it very quickly. And here we go. So yes, so my email is epwilli1@asu.edu. You can go there to, or you can email me at that email address, and I should be able to get back very quickly. And I also left a link to my main webpage for my art, because in the future it might actually be a good place for me to sell prints, and you can view updates. You don't need to have an account to view the work, so I don't know if you need it to buy prints, but anyway, so you can view more of my works there, kind of navigate around. And then I also left this additional email. I'm not planning on using it much currently, but if you do struggle to contact me through the first email, then you can email me through there, and I will try to look through that one as well. Yeah, so feel free to let me know if you have any questions, and I really appreciate that you were here for the presentation. And, you know, stay safe, stay healthy, and have a good day or night. Bye.
Hi. My name is Tatiana Ginzburg, and I'm going to give a talk about consciousness. And I will illustrate some ideas with the slides, which you will see right now, hopefully. So, my talk called Embracing the Embraceable, Unembraceable, or Possibility of Consciousness Cognition. So why I put the name like that? Because I've been actively participating in the consciousness movement in transpersonal psychology in Russia and in US and in Europe for more than 20 years. And quite often I met people who also was quite involved in a consciousness study, but they have a position that consciousness is not possible to cognize or conceive in full. So completeness of cognition is not possible. So here I want to doubt this idea, especially if it's not possible, how do you know about that? So I chosen the word embrace because I want to talk more than just cognition in an irrational sense, but the idea that I want to think and maybe think together with you about, is the consciousness is possible to cognize, to grasp or embrace in some point. But first, I want to illustrate that unknowability for the consciousness is quite a common idea. For example, this is a quotation of Alan Combs, who is a leader of the Center for Consciousness Study, and he is teaching consciousness study in CIAS in San Francisco. But still, he is writing that consciousness is impossible to define. It's like light that illuminates, but it's not seen. It's like a clear stream through which we see the brilliantly colored stones on the bottom. It is emptiness itself, translucent, transparent, and so on. So the idea that consciousness is something like an emptiness, which could not be really defined or really known. And in order to study this idea, I will begin with trying to understand different concepts of consciousness. So the most popular concept is the concept that consciousness is a qualia. It became the most popular after the Thomas Nagel paper, which called What is Like to be a Bat. So qualia is something which is how, what is like to be someone, like what is like to be Tatiana Ginzburg. This is about uniqueness of somebody. And so people, especially in the conscious study, try to see on the consciousness through this. The consciousness is the qualia. Maybe it's effective, but maybe not. In order to understand that, I will try to look at what would it be, how to describe the phenomena in a good way. So this is the idea how I would suggest to describe the phenomena ideally. So I see that the great way to describe the phenomena is to describe the concept, and to describe the concept at first through the core. So what is the core of this phenomena? And to formulate the definition, and not just with the different words, but I will understand the definition as defining the limit, which will limit this phenomena and let us to make a distinction between this phenomena and the other phenomena. For example, between consciousness and psyche, or consciousness and mind. Because in a way that consciousness is a quality, it's quite difficult to understand both of these things. And where is it? What is the core of these concepts, and what is the limits? How can we separate consciousness and psyche, for example? So ideally, understanding of phenomena will give us the core and definition in the sense of defining limits. And having that in mind, I will try to look at different concept of consciousness. I took this basic concept of consciousness from Thomas Natsos, who actually analyzed six basic definition from Oxford English Dictionary. Thomas Natsos is a psychologist, professor emeritus of Davis University, and he was studying different concepts of consciousness for ages, and he put a very, very detailed papers about all the consciousness definitions. So, consciousness one. Natsos called it interpersonal meaning. And these definitions comes from etymology of the word, which comes from con and skia. And because of skia from old Latin, it's a knowledge, and con is togetherness. So both of these words give us joint or mutual knowledge. I am native Russian speaker, so for me, in Russian language, consciousness, the word consciousness, сознание, built the same way. It also comes from two words, со and знание. Both of them is like con, togetherness, and knowledge, знание. So I like this definition because it's a very correspond to Russian word, and I think that it's a really basic for the consciousness. And Thomas Natsos give a lot of quotation, and here I'm giving the quotation from Leviathan: when two or more men knows of one and the same fact, they are said to be conscious of it, one to another. So this definition is actually meant that when two people, two persons, has the same knowledge, they are conscious of it. Natsol said that it's quite old and maybe not the popular definition right now, but it one for the beginning. Conscious too, that's also called personal meaning. And it comes when the first definition is taken inside. So I am taking inside someone, and now I'm having this knowledge inside of me. And usually these definitions mean that I know something about myself. The most clear way of using that definition is when I know about my guilt or what I did or my innocence. And it also very, very corresponds to psychology knowledge about consciousness, psychology development of this process. So in the Soviet, psychology was a very popular theory of interiorization created by Lev Semyonovich Vygotsky, and he pointed that the consciousness was the result when I taking inside all the voices, all the people who surround me from the childhood. So when I do this work, finally I get this consciousness. And in American psychology was George Herbert Mead with the same theory. So the personality or my personal consciousness comes together with me building as a social object. When I became a social, and when I really get all the social relationship inside, I became someone who has a consciousness. But still, this idea built on a knowledge. Now, what is consciousness free? In English, it's defined as awareness, or the state or fact of being mentally conscious or aware of anything. But because of Russian language, again, in Russian, awareness has the same root. It's the same as consciousness in English. So in order to translate it in Russian, I needed to understand what's awareness really mean. What's the main point of awareness? What does it mean to be aware? So reading attentively to Thomas Netzel's articles, I came to the point that awareness at first means to be attentive in here and now. And Thomas wrote that it's quite often connected with a feeling. So difference between consciousness three and consciousness two, in a way that the consciousness three, it's not just knowledge, is also feelings. And it means that I am presented, I am in a moment here and now, and I can react and I can perceive what is happening. But thinking about that, I understand that there are two possibilities to understand the theory. One is that consciousness is which every biological organism has, like animal or plant, because all these biological organisms are sensible to the what is happening. All the biological organism has a perception and can react. So one possibility to understand this consciousness is to see that any living organism has a consciousness, and the irritability, this is also the word from Russian psychology, irritability is ability which allow living organism to live. And in Soviet psychology, we see that any organism which had irritability is really has a psyche. Another point of view on consciousness, that the human being is the main creatures which has consciousness, and in this case the mind is a distinction point. So the irritability not enough, it also needed some intention or some kind of will which human being can combine with perception, and only after that, after the integration perception and will, there will be consciousness. So I will open this question till the next discovery, but I think that the even clear question sometimes can allow to find the truth. So here I shown the several possibility to define the consciousness. So we can define the consciousness as something which is only for humans. And in this case, will or mind will be the separation line. We can define the consciousness for the living creatures. And in this case, irritability will be separation line. Or we even can see on the consciousness as something which is everything penetrate everything, even matter. And in this case, being, just to be, will mean that just to be by being I have a consciousness. So this is kind of different stages of looking at the consciousness. Now let's go back to what Netzels also see in the Oxford Dictionary. So Netzels describes three more definitions. consciousness for is reflective meaning, and it means that if I can reflect on my thoughts, feeling, or volition, I am conscious. And thinking more deeply on this definition, that souls find out that, like, in precise understanding, this definition is underneath the first three. So in order to get any knowledge, especially to understand that this knowledge is mine, I need first to be reflective. Consciousness five is unity of meaning. And this is totality of impressions, thoughts, and feelings which make up a person consciousness being. So it means that I unite myself, like I see the uniqueness of myself, and all the thoughts is mine. So, and the capacity to see on everything as mine is this type of consciousness. And when it also shows the new, how the consciousness is used in 20th century, and the new expression like raising consciousness or spreading the consciousness, he described actually this definition, it's the meaning of that. And finally, the consciousness six and general state meaning. So it's kind of, if the consciousness is what human have, so we can define the consciousness opposite way. So it's something which is human has. So it's a normal, healthy way of life. Now, metaphorically looking on all these definitions, we can see that the consciousness is like an elephant where six different blind people look at, and each one is describing different parts. So and in this case we have a partial definition, we have a partial description, and the same question is still present. Can we really describe or comprehend consciousness in full? In order to do that, let's again look how we actually look at the consciousness. And in a classical approach in science, we have subject-object separation, where subject look at object. We have a duality. And if we describe the matter, for example, we have something, some materialistic ball, we can look at on that from different sides and describe it. And so subject-object separation perfectly works. But when we try to study some kind of object, like a consciousness, which is not clearly object, we have some problems. And this problem in Russian psychology called psychophysical problem, in Western philosophy called heart problem. But it's the same problem which comes from this duality. So because we don't really know, is subject dependent on an object? When we research the consciousness, we can't fully make a correct research. So let's see what else can we do. In the 20th century, one of the main discovery was that influence of observer on observation. So non-classical approach means that I, as a researcher, research not only object, but I research all the process of observation, and I can see how observer influence on an object. But even in this case, I can't see the borders of the consciousness. So maybe even such an approach would not fully work in the conscious study. So we will try to see a post non-classical approach. Russian philosopher Vyacheslav Semyonovich Stepin created the idea of these different approaches, and he created the idea that in science, in some type of rational science, some approaches can be more correctly used. So this is my application of post-non-classical approach to the consciousness. So from my point of view, this is the most correct way of researching consciousness, because consciousness is something which I can look inside myself. And in this case, I can try to understand the core of this phenomenon. And post-non-classical approach said that if I really will look at these phenomena from all possible position, but to inward, like inside, I can finally get to the point of I, or me, I choosing the word I. So from the beginning, it could be that I will find at least myself, like Tatiana Ginzburg, who is sitting right now in St. Petersburg and giving this talk to the computer. And this could be the first point, and it actually will correspond to the many definitions which has been given by Netzholz, like reflection or personal knowledge. But in attempt to making the next step, which usually Eastern tradition do, I can understand that I not limited with such a body or with this place. And if I really understand I amness, or if I not even understand, if I experience that, and that happens with me once, that I had an experience of I amness, and this wasn't limited amness, it was being everything, like described in the Buddhist tradition. For example, this is a picture of one of the pictures of 10 bulls model of enlightenment, and this one is an 8 bull, where the bull and the self transcended. So finally, my I amness could be transcended to everything. And in this case, I will embrace the unbraceable consciousness or unbraceable amness. That's a picture of such a possibility. And on this thought, I want to stop, and I invite you in such an exploration of I amness. Спасибо, всего доброго. Это моя фотография с попытки объять необъятное.
Hello, my name is Eugene Pustoshkin. I'm clinical psychologist in private practice. Also, I am chief editor of the Eros and Cosmos online journal. And I am primary translator of the works of Ken Wilber, an integral philosopher who writes on consciousness, psychotherapy and spirituality. I translate his works to Russian. With my colleague Tatyana Parfenova, psychological consultant, mindfulness teacher, and co-author of this presentation, we teach integral meditation. Together with Tatiana Parfenova and Sergei Kuprianov, we co-teach Holoscendence. Holoscendence is a method of psychotherapy and communication and also spiritual growth founded by Sergei Kuprianov. So, what is integral meditation? Integral meditation is an integrative experiential system of contemplative mindfulness development. It is also a complex technique of psychotherapeutic intervention. We use it in psychotherapy processes, and we teach how to use it in psychotherapy processes. Integral meditation is based on holoscendence, and as I mentioned, holoscendence is a therapeutic meta-method founded by Sergei Kuprianov. And integral theory of consciousness, which is a framework founded by Ken Wilber, Alan Combs, and others. Integral meditation is also informed by various research paradigms, such as Leonid and Dmitry Spivak's research of altered states of consciousness. He's been there, their team were conducting altered states research at the Human Brain Institute in Saint-Petersburg. Also included are adult development theories, for instance, Robert Keegan's framework of stages of development, as well as Jane Lovinger's and Suzanne Kogreuter's models of ego development. Interpersonal neurobiology, as explained by Daniel Siegel, trauma studies. I personally admire Bessel van der Kolk's work, body psychotherapy, somatic psychology, and various transpersonal psychology methods. Integral meditation is a combination of awareness-based psychotechnologies developed by Soviet and post-Soviet consciousness researchers. What I refer here is certain techniques which are called advanced deconcentration techniques. They were developed in the practice of psychotherapy, occupational psychology, extreme sports trainings, etc. And these techniques were discovered and developed by researchers, practitioners in Leningrad, now St. Petersburg, Moscow and Kyiv in 70s and 80s of the last century. Also, integral meditation includes an extensive phenomenology of non-pharmacological altered states of consciousness, the states of consciousness which emerge in individual psychotherapy settings as well as in group work and meditation retreats, where intense psychoemotional experiences are manifesting quite often. Integral meditation has been applied by us in process of individual psychotherapy and counseling, group work, including hundreds of individual and group online sessions. Integral meditation includes an integral psychotherapy framework. It is not only classical psychological and psychotherapeutic techniques, but also a nuanced integral understanding of the spectrum of psychopathology and therapy. It allows us to integrate multi-level shadow material. Shadow is everything that is repressed into our unconscious. So this makes integral meditation applicable to trauma healing and psychedelic experience integration, among other things. So integral meditation has been tested and practiced by us in over 100 workshops, including extended week-long retreats. The integral meditation has been taught as a singular event and also as several long-term training programs. People study integral meditation over a few months. It involves integral meditation courses per se, and also it is taught as a subcomponent of holoscendence courses, which we co-lead together with Sergei Kuprianov. And Sergei has experimented with these practices for more than 30 years in clinical practice, psychotherapy, and individual counseling. And our own experience includes countless individual sessions. So our span of subjects who were participating in experiments with this method involves several hundreds of participants over several years. Integral meditation quickly induces altered states of consciousness, both in novice practitioners and in advanced practitioners. This is some kind of finding which is very interesting, because people who try it for the first time often experience a full-blown altered state of consciousness. In the beginners, altered states of consciousness could last from a few moments to 30 minutes and more. In advanced practitioners, the states can be experienced continuously in a fluctuating or stabilized plateau-like fashion. Abraham Maslow spoke about plateau experiences in the end of his career, so I refer to his term plateau experience. So integral meditation states can last throughout the day, and sometimes they manifest in dreaming states, for instance in lucid dreaming. You can practice these methods. Specific techniques of stabilizing and anchoring altered meditative states were developed by us in application to integral meditation. So, what kind of alternations of consciousness are observed when we apply this method? We have observed significant shifts in perceptive fields in our subjects, which includes most notably vivid oscillations of the visual field, often described by subjects as psychedelic visionary experiences, and shifts in auditory experience. Also, alternations in somatic self-sense. People describe fluctuations of bodily experiences, including changes in subjective feelings of body temperature, and alternations in muscle body tensions, and also how emotional experience manifests in embodiment. What also changes is time experience. Sometimes time radically slows down, at other times it accelerates. I mean felt time, which Mark Whitman's books Felt Time talks about. Emotional experience, as I noted, also undergoes changes. For instance, subjects often report vivid experiences of rapture, joy, compassion, and so on. And also they gain access to their deeper feelings of sorrow, which because of that we can work with it. Interpersonal relational experience also is alternated. For instance, people observe increased rapport, empathy, trust, shared psycho-emotional experience, shifts in self-other perception, shifts in facial perception, and we use the shifts in facial perception as a psychotherapy intervention technique. We show how people see each other's faces, and they often think that the other person's face is something constant, unchanging, and stable, while this meditation shows how we construct our experience of the face of the other person. And people who work in psychotherapy, I'm sure, would understand how important this experience of the other, of his or her face, is to any human being. And we observed many other experiences, including intense peak experiences and experiences in lucid dreaming. Integral meditation can be used as a tool to work with various objects. It can involve immediate sensory objects, and also it can involve very complex objects, such as objectifying stages of child and adult development. In our integral meditation trainings, we teach our students various stages of child development and also of adult development, and offer them guided visualizations, guided meditations, and people often describe very intense psycho-emotional states that emerge because of that practice. Also, integral meditation can be used to understand very complex mental concepts such as hyperobjects. Hyperobject is something which spans which has an enormous span in terms of territory, and also it has non-linear temporal connections, and it is extended in time. For instance, one of the most famous hyperobjects is climate change. And also we applied integral meditation in our workshop to work with the current COVID-19 pandemic as a hyperobject. and people gain psychological and also intellectual insights into this complex system of hyperobject, such as the pandemic. Integral meditation has been producing profound experience of altered states of consciousness, including resurfacing and reintegration of forgotten traumatic experiences from childhood. Also, enhancement of thinking processes, often described as more pleasurable than thinking in an ordinary state. Integral meditation is practiced with your eyes open. So, because we practice with our eyes open, it can be practiced in daily activities. It can be integrated with most, if not all, activities of the day. People describe how they do integral meditation during business meetings, during their coaching sessions, and also during driving. And during driving, many drivers experience these states spontaneously. The experiential findings were applied by us not just to inducing varieties of meditative states, but also to communication and daily work activities. We have experience of conducting relational work and also corporate personal trainings. We have built a sophisticated system of contemplative phenomenology based on integral meditation. It can be enacted not only in an introverted formal meditation setting when a person practices on his or her own, but also, as I mentioned in extroverted daily activities, which require active participation of the subject in his or her own surroundings. In the instances of interpersonal conflict resolution, business meetings, physical sports activities, learning, and ordinary interpersonal communication. Integral meditation has offered us essential phenomenological data on how human consciousness is functioning in its various states, including subjective processes, which can be called first-person approaches, intersubjective dynamics, which can be called something which belongs to second-person approaches, and also objective dynamics. Specifically, we explore how first-person and second-person dynamics influences the construction of perception of third-person objects, such as physical items or physical human features. People describe how other person's faces changes, as I mentioned, or they describe how their surroundings, their perception of objective surrounding starts to change. They see it in a more there's more light in the room while the objective light is the same, or it becomes darker, for instance. Or they see fractal geometry intertwined with the objects, and they start to understand how their object perception is actually a complex process of construction. So our findings support, at least partially, the constructivist approaches to consciousness. Integral meditation is a kind of meditation which is deliberate practice of intentionality, allows us to see consciousness as a very plastic, dynamic, and connective dimension of our being in the world. We practice integral meditation in communication, in psychotherapy, in work activities, and we see how due to our application of the specific techniques which involve equal redistribution of awareness throughout all sensory channels and also throughout mental channels, we see how the reality of consciousness, how its processes shift and fluctuate. And even thinking processes, when we sit in a meditation process, we undergo changes of consciousness states, and our mind becomes more spacious, more expansive, and we can work with more complex issues, both involving human relations or such sophisticated cognitive concepts as hyperobjects, as I mentioned before. So our findings suggest that consciousness is very plastic, dynamic, and we can influence it by psychotechnologies, and this states which emerge out of that, they can be shared with other people, and they can be experienced continuously throughout the day and throughout communication with other people. And we have repeatedly shown that we can train people, experience these states, and even novice practitioners who do it for the first time or second time, they experience these profound states and peak experiences. And we also show how in the experience of people who practice integral meditation, they study their own psyche, they study their own consciousness. So this kind of paradigm of using psychotechnology, psychotechniques to alter one's state of consciousness in order to study it from within and interpersonally seems to be very promising. Thank you very much.
Hello everybody, and welcome to our presentation about the natural language of the body, movement in awareness to consciousness. My name is Talma Targan. I'm a graduate of Ben Gurion University in Israel with a bachelor's degree in engineering. After an injury as a dancer, I turned to the field of rehabilitation through movement. And today I'm a master trainer in the gyrokinesis method and other movement approaches, working as a coach and a therapist through the integration of consciousness in movement. In this lecture, we will see how connection to the source through the body enables a return to the wisdom and knowledge that exist within us naturally. Such a connection leads to optimal functioning at all levels, physical, emotional, and mental, and includes improvement in posture, movement and breathing patterns, and healing of various problems and pains. In the second part of the lecture, we will practice the approach physically and experientially. I invite you to prepare next to you a glass or a bottle of water and take off your shoes. First, let us look at conventional movement and physical healing approaches. These refer to the body as a machine with separate parts connected to each other. The concept of healing in these approaches holds that repairing or replacing the impaired element itself will return the system to full optimal functioning. Examples of these concepts are separated exercises for each muscle in the gym, or taking the designated medications. More advanced approaches see the body as a unit made up of closed systems separated from each other. Practicing these approaches relates to the specific system and operates on it. For example, Feldenkrais is a method of movement that was developed out of reference to the skeletal system. Chiropractic has evolved as a healing approach that treats the skeletal system. Using manipulations on the skeletal system, both approaches strive to impact additional systems and solve various problems. In the unconventional movement approaches, to cure an impaired element, movement chains are usually used, creating healing through manipulation of specific places in the relevant chain. Other methods defined as holistic today, such as Chinese medicine, perceive the body as a closed system that affects itself and works to balance the body within and in relation to itself. When an impaired element is diagnosed, the approach is that the whole system has gone out of balance. Consequently, the healing comes from working on rebalance the whole system. You can see in the picture that there are intertwined lines in a closed system, which is the circle. A tear or a knot in a specific crossing point on the vertical lines will create damage in the entire system and will pull lines to different directions that will harm the efficient functioning of the whole unit. Healing in this approach will happen with rebalancing all the lines back to vertical, which eventually release the knot and will make room for rebuilding the tear. All healing happens through rebalancing this closed circle system. So far, we have talked about the existing methods. We will now try to understand where the approach we offer evolved from. So, who do you think controls our body? The Western way of life brought about complete control of the thinking mind. This condition eliminates the use of the knowledge inherent in every cell of our body. If we connect to the same natural wisdom rooted in the body, we will reach healing in the right and best way for us. In our approach, the cosmic consciousness resonates in each and every cell in our body and is the source of our wisdom of existence. When we expand the perception of the body from one unit separated from the world to understanding that we are only a part of the whole universe, we connect to the wisdom of the source. We understand today that our body is part of a larger system. One of the things we already know today, for example, is that through us passes the electromagnetic field that creates the torus. This energetic structure affects the flow within our body. When we are not aware of its existence, we block its positive effect, and thus it creates blockages and disturbances in the body. Connection to the torus and experience of its existence within and around us allow our body to enjoy energetic effects on it and actually live the way nature intended for us. So how do you do that physically? When we know that most of our body is made up of fluid, first we need to internalize the sense of movement of fluids in our body and understand that external forces operating on the body affect the movement of fluids within. The intercellular fluid is driven by the muscles, and therefore when we allow ourselves to be affected by the external forces like gravitational forces or cosmic gravity too, it creates a change in the organization of our muscles along with change in the movement of fluids. This will also be followed by a change in the overall organization of the entire posture, and thus will also have a profound impact on our overall health. Let us try to feel things a little. I ask you now to take a large sip of water from your glass or bottle and keep it in your mouth for a moment. When you swallow, feel how the water dissipates in the body and unites with the huge fluid reservoir within us. Feel the huge inner ocean that lives within us, the waves of motion of water in the great ocean. Now pour another bucket of water into this ocean. Through another sip, you take and stay for a while with this experience. Now I ask you to stand up straight on the ground. The feet are pelvic wide, and you open the tactile sense on the skin of the feet and feel the points of connection between you and the world you touch. You can note that if you lean forward with your pelvis or push your body down, it will be difficult to use the tactile sense. You will feel more pressure on your feet or heavy leaning on it. Try now to feel what needs to change in your posture to allow the skin on your feet to release and reach a state of better sensing. you can now also walk a little in the room. Feel the internal movement upwards that happens in the inside of the legs through the center line of the body all the way to the top of the head. In other words, when we are sensually connected through the tactile sense to the space around us, an energetic movement begins up the central axis. This is how we self-prepare our personal torus, which goes up and around us. For the next exercise, touch your arms. Moving your palms along them, rub or pat your back. Massage the entire body cover, the legs, your pelvis, your sides. So when you touch all the cover, all the sensors of the skin will send a message to the system saying that we are open to experience the universe. So now stop and feel how the skin is released. Under the skin, the different layers begin to open. The fascia layer, the outer muscle layer opens, an internal movement of the muscles supporting and lifting the core is coming to life. In this way, simultaneously, we allow opening to the universe while strengthening the self. Physically situated in our inner core, the outer cover opens and the immanence is gathered on the same time. Finally, let us now look at the effects of our thinking mind. When we sit for long hours in front of a computer or in a car, we abolish our connection to the body and intensify the use of the front of our brain. This weakens the function of the ancient parts. Intuition decreases and we feel compelled to use controlled thoughts because we have lost the connection to our motor and behavior instincts. Place your palms now on the base of the skull. Release the tongue to the lower palate and release the joints between the jaws. Now really rest, try and rest into the lower back of the head. The arms are supporting this rest. Sensory presence in this area connects us through the organs of the cerebellum and the brainstem back to the ability of standing up straight without effort in a natural good posture and using positive patterns without control. You can feel that if you rest within yourself backwards, an internal upward flow is in the spine begins. The ribs rise and the whole body lifts only because you release the front lobe of the brain and let it rest. In other words, the best posture does not happen out of effort, but only by freeing our mind, clinging to the thinking mind, and shifting attention to places that allow us the experience to experience ourselves as part of the universe. In conclusion, the natural language of the body is derived from understanding that our body is only a part of the whole universe. When we allow ourselves to experience it, movement patterns and ways of healing develop from a connection to intelligent cosmic consciousness. Contact info will follow at the end of the dance. Enjoy! The language of the body is built from movement that serves the body's physical and emotional needs while implementing them in the surrounding world in all its diversity and challenges. Through intuitive dance, all spectrum of movements and emotions can be expressed so that we use and not lose all diversity of bodily functions. This dance came out of opening the senses in the skin through movement, stretching the cover of the body, and through touching between the body and the space around it. This resulted in the experience of the torus and its effects on the body, bringing opening and centering to the body and soul all on the same time.
Thank you.
interested to delve deeper into this topic is welcome to find me on Facebook under the name Talma Targan or the Movement Clinic Israel. And I added my contact details below. You can call me at any time. Thank you and have a nice and fulfilling day. Bye.
Hi, I'd like to introduce you to a lay-level model in neuroscience. It's called impulsing, and it gives us a way of tracing impulse activity in the nervous system and describing the work that it does, especially in areas of an inner circuitry that we'll call the conscious pathways. Well, I'm Denise Ingebo. I'm an independent theorist in neuroscience, the study of the nervous system at the lay level. This theory is very simplified. It's a lay-level theory, and it's based on simplified structure and theoretical activity. So I found the nervous system is made up of groups of specialized neurons that are linked together to form pathways that reach inward to groups packed together that form the brain, for example. Altogether, these linked neuron groups form a circuitry. Now, I also found that neuroscientists associate an inner circuitry of the system, four linked areas, to four kinds of conscious work. And in this model, we'll show how in the first area, from the sensory neuron groups of the body to the thalamus, a set of groups near the center of the brain, we'll see how we experience sensation. In the second area, from the thalamus to the cortex, we'll see how impulsing forms records in us of each conscious instant. And when that record sinks into records made in the past, we experience recognition. In the third area, from the cortex back to the thalamus, we'll see how impulsing derives thoughts. And then in the fourth area, from the cortex to muscle tissue and then back to the thalamus, we'll see how feelings, these subtle tensions that sometimes increase in intensity, are experienced in us. So in the fourth area, we see how our feelings are formed and released. Now for activity or energy in the system, I found that impulses constantly circulate throughout the system. So for this model, we'll also define consciousness or the conscious stream as a series or stream of separate conscious instants, sensations, thoughts, feelings, in patterns. So you know that we experience a thought, then a minute ago it was a sensation, a different thought, a different feeling. This is the stream of consciousness. It's made up of separate conscious instants. Now the lay level theory that I'm going to describe is very simplified, but it can be described in two parts. The first part is about energy. It's about how energy in the form of impulses or impulse trails energizes the nervous system. It's like electricity energizes an appliance. So that's the first part. Then the second part, we'll apply that, we'll apply impulsing to show the work that's done in those four areas of that inner circuitry in the nervous system. Part one, energy. Well, the nervous system, like all natural and man-made systems, uses energy to do its work. Well, where does the nervous system get its energy? Well, it's constantly exposed to many forms of energy in the body and in the environment. And as each sensory group absorbs a pattern of energy that it's designed to monitor, it changes the character of that group. Remember, this is a very simplified model. And when it changes the character of that group, it expresses its newly updated state as a pattern of impulses to the next neuron group. And that in turn expresses its new state to the next group. and the next, forming a lightning-like series of energized neuron groups. So each group changes character as it's energized, and it expresses that newly updated character to the next group, forming this lightning-like series of energized neuron groups. This is an impulse trail, or impulsing. Now in the circuitry, impulse trails often converge on the same neuron group. And when they energize the same pattern in that group, they form a resolution. They identify what they have in common. So those incoming impulse trails are resolved. And this is relevant information. So when this group is energized and updated, it expresses its new state as relevant information to further groups down the line. Now, as energy accumulates on this pattern that these incoming trails have in common, the pattern becomes more intense. The intensity increases. And this inherent intensity propels a stronger trail deeper into the circuitry. Now, looking at impulse trails evolving, we can see that activity in the system is maintained by the absorption and the convergence of energy. It's absorbed in the periphery, and then it's converged within the circuitry, maintaining activity or propulsion in the system. So with the absorbing and converging energy in the system in mind, we can infer that the primary work of the system is to monitor and resolve. And soon we'll see how maintaining fluent monitoring and resolving activity determines the character or the fluency of our emotional balance. Okay, let's follow an impulse trail in the conscious pathways. Here, a sensory group absorbs a pattern of energy that it's designed to. The character of that sensory group changes. Its updated state, in this case, it's a pressure on a finger. The pattern is expressed to the next neuron group, and the next, until it reaches the thalamus. Now, the thalamus is this set of groups packed together near the center of the brain that neuroscientists associate with consciousness. So, a series of energized groups reaches the thalamus, and the trail splits to energize a set of thalamus groups when it reaches the thalamus. Now, these groups represent potential qualities of a conscious instant. Here's an example. Here's an image of clouds in the sky. So there's two kinds of qualities in the thalamus, sense-specific and intersensory. So sense-specific qualities of the sense vision are blue, in this case, white, and the edges of clouds. Intersensory qualities are light and softness. So intersensory qualities can be a part of the makeup of instance of other senses. Conscious instants of sound, smell, taste, and touch can all have the inner sensory qualities of light or softness in their makeup. Well, a model also proposes that each trail that enters and energizes the thalamus puts an instant of consciousness, a single instant of consciousness, into our evolving, ongoing conscious stream. It's like adding a frame onto a reel of film. And like adding frames on a reel of film, conscious instants blur together to form a seamless experience in us. And this seamless experience is consciousness. Part two, we'll see how four kinds of conscious instants are formed: sensation, recognition, thoughts, and feelings. First is experiencing sensation. So here again, we start with a sensory group that's energized when it absorbs a pattern of energy, in this case, pressure. When a sensory group absorbs a pattern of energy, that pattern of energized neurons translates the energy that it's absorbed into another form of energy, the electrochemical energy that we call impulses. So when the sensory group absorbs a pattern of energy, it changes its character and it expresses its updated state as a pattern of impulses to the next neuron group, and the next, and so on, until it reaches the thalamus, where the trail splits to energize a set of thalamus groups, again, that represent the qualities of a conscious instant. Now, this happens so quickly, that we experience these energized neuron groups simultaneously as a unit, as an instant of sensation in us. Now, the second kind of conscious work is about forming a record of each conscious instant we experience into a vast lifelong network of records. So when the impulse trail reaches the thalamus, it splits to energize a set of thalamus groups. Now, from there, the trail remains split, and it fans out to enter the cortex, to enter patches of the cortex. These are patches that correspond to the same qualities as in the thalamus. So the cortex is a thin, quilt-like blanket covering the surface of the brain. It's made up of layers of neurons. And as the trail from the thalamus splits, the impulses energize the same layer of the cortex, and they instantly spread over the surface of the cortex. Now they're in different patches, so they're in different areas, until they collide. And when they collide, the neurons involved are fused together, the neurons going back to points of entry into the cortex. So altogether, they form a permanent record of each conscious instant that we experience into a vast network of records. And in the future, energy or impulses into any part of this record energizes the rest of the record. This is a record of a single conscious instant. Now, often another trail into the network from a different sense forms a record. And if that record has any of the same qualities as the first conscious instant we just talked about, they're fused at those qualities. So that makes an enlarged record. So let's look at some examples. So the French word chat for cat has a sharp T sound, as does the English word. So the word chat or cat fuses with the qualities of a cat's claws, which are sharp, or a hiss sound. That's where they fuse. That's where they connect. And that's an enlarged record. Another example is le chaton. Obviously not pronouncing that right, but that's the French word for kitten. And in both cases, the soft N sound is fused, is matched to the softness of a kitten's fur. Now the Chinese word for cat is mao. Okay, so you can understand how this sound fuses to what we hear a cat making. Now, when a series of trails enter the cortex from the same sense, many of those qualities are the same from instant to instant, like frames of film have many qualities from one frame to the next. So there's lots of connections here. And this is where we make records of activities. What has happened, how to do something. This is a temporal record. Now, another part of the network that's made is the part that fuses muscle tension to the tone or sound muscle tension makes as it ranges from tight to loose. So we're talking about muscle in place. We're not talking about the muscle that moves the body. We're talking about muscle in the chest and the face, the kind of muscle that ranges in place from tense to loose or relaxed. So these are the muscles that move in place from tense to relaxed. And as they do so, they elicit a matching tone or sensation. And that tone from sharp to soft is fused to the muscle position it matches. So tight is sharp, loose is softer. In other words, when a muscle in place changes from tense to relaxed, the tone or sensation changes from sharp to soft. This is a part of the network of records that we'll soon call upon. Now, after a record is made, the trail's residual energy sinks into adjacent related records, the records that have any of the same qualities in common. So an image of the blue sky will go on to relate records made in the past having blue in their makeup. And when a residual energy sinks into its adjacent related records, we experience a sense of recognition in our conscious stream. So we only recognize something if there's related records for its residual or leftover energy to sink into. Now, as energy sinks into related records that have any of its qualities in common, energy continues into the network for as far as the intensity of the incoming trail takes it. So, as a trail finishes making a record, it goes on to energize an area of the network related to it. So here's an example, say, of a thought and then an area of the network having any of the qualities of the thought in their makeup. So let's go on to the third area of this inner circuitry and look at the conscious work from the cortex back to the thalamus. As I just mentioned, as a trail comes in, it energizes an area of the network. Another trail comes in, it energizes another area. And when they overlap on a pattern that they have in common, this overlap pattern is reinforced. And when the areas overlap on a common pattern, this is a resolution. The content of these areas is resolved. And this reinforced pattern then is generated back to the thalamus, putting an instant of thought into our conscious stream. An instant of thought made up of these qualities. So for example, if we say the word orange, and then we say the word sky, the pattern they have in common derives a trail back to the thalamus, which we may experience in the sunset. Now, when there's no resolution, we often repeat one of the trails into that cortex. So when we repeat it, the intensity in that area expands the energized area. And when it does so, it makes a resolution, a common pattern, more likely. Or when there's not a resolution when we're awake, when we're sleeping, we resolve the energized areas that weren't resolved when we were awake. And we call this dreaming. They may not make sense, but we wake up with a clean slate. We feel refreshed because those energized areas have been resolved in the form of dreams. Conscious work in area four is also about resolving energized areas in the cortex, but these are two different kinds of energized areas. One of them is the muscle, and the other is a sensation or a thought. So these areas include the muscle tones matched to muscle tension, as I mentioned, in the face and the chest and arms and legs, and the background tones of either a sensation or a thought. So when these areas overlap, they generate a trail to the muscle that replicates the pattern both of those areas have in common. In other words, they propel a trail to the muscle that stimulates a tension pattern that elicits the same tonal pattern as the current sensation or thought. And then when this muscle tension pattern or this reflective pattern reaches back to the thalamus, we experience a sensation, a subtle sensation in our conscious stream. We experience a feeling. Now, this is a physical counterpart that reflects the presence of every sensation or thought we experience in our conscious stream. It's second nature. Now, when the sensation or thought is no longer present, the tension is released. And we experience this reversal of tension. It's a kind of balance. It's comfortable. We experience as a kind of balance that we call a balanced feeling or emotional balance. It's a feeling of relief that's often subtle and a comfort. However, when the sensation or the thought is steady and it's not released, it's not changed, the tension can increase, making it more likely to get our attention. That's good. It often signals the need for a resolution. But if there's no resolution and the tension increases when the sensation or thought feels stuck, then the tension we experience ranges from a sense of need to disappointment, frustration, depression, anxiety. It's emotional pain that signals a need for a resolution. So if we're in a room and we're constantly looking at the same walls, that same pattern is stimulated over and over, we call this boredom. But it's why we don't bump into walls or don't bump into each other. We are constantly generating these reflective tension patterns. So let's have a little demonstration. Put your finger about an inch from your cheek and make a circle in the air. Does your cheek feel it? Can you feel that? Some can, some can't. I can. Now change that to an X. Does the feeling on your cheek change? Well, these are reflective tensions of the sensation of an image. It's why classical music is soothing and rock and roll music is energizing. That's how it affects our muscle. Now, since stress signals a need for resolution and releasing tension indicates a resolution is occurring, we can see that our feelings reflect how fluent our current mantra and resolving activity is in this part of the nervous system. Now, this model can also be used at the lay level. Now, we can use it particularly with the concepts of area four in mind to better orient ourselves to why people behave the way they do in homes and societies everywhere. So when a sensation or thought becomes stuck in someone, the stress or tension rises. And when the tension rises too much, we can see why people do what they do to get this tension out, to move it along. They can shout, yell, kick, fight. They can even hurt someone else just to get it out, whatever it takes. As a matter of fact, greed is a way of avoiding this kind of pain in the future. For me anyway, it's given me a sense of sympathy. But I'm comforted that we're all designed to resolve whatever we're exposed to. We're all designed to work out what we experience. It's our nature. But going forward, since the model shows that balanced feelings reflect emotional health, we can help each other build lifestyles, a pattern of activities that keep feelings balanced. Well, we start with activities in infancy that provide balance to physiological needs. For hunger, for warmth, for sleep, for example. So on this base of meeting physiological needs, we can include activities that provide exposures and resources so we each can develop our own personal pattern of activities that meets personal interests and social needs. We can develop personal activities based on our character, our physical character, our interests, and the nature of our social environment. And with exposures and resources available, so for social needs, we can incorporate activities that restore the resources that we use as we use them. As we restore the resources we use, we can maintain environmental integrity, right? Gardening in a solar-powered home comes to mind. Well, I'm Denise Ingebo. I'm an independent theorist in neuroscience. And this is a lay-level model for us lay people. For contact information, the email address is impulsing@icloud.com. So I plan to incorporate responses to questions and comments in the dedicated website, impulsing.net. So if you'd like to help or you'd like more information, visit impulsing.net. And thank you. And let's take care of each other.
Welcome to the emergence of miracles in living systems.
The intersection of caring sustainability and cross-cultural shamanism. I'm Martha Brumbaugh.
I'm Debby Flickinger. The agenda will consist of an introduction to Martha and I. We will participate in a centering exercise. I will explain the Watson effect and caring sustainability. And the ability.
Do you want to start all over?
Yeah, we can. So let me, I'll just pause it. I'll pause the recording and we'll start again. Welcome to the Emergence of Miracles in Living Systems.
The intersection of caring sustainability and cross-cultural shamanism. I'm Martha Brumbaugh.
And I'm Debbie Flickinger. The agenda will consist of an introduction to Martha and I. We will participate in a centering exercise. I will explain the Watson effect and caring sustainability, as well as the ability to be open to miracles.
I will talk to you about the intersection of caring sustainability and cultural, cross-cultural shamanism. And then I'll explain my experience of the shamanic journey. And we'll actually do a brief journey and find our wisdom tree. Afterwards, we'll close and encourage everyone to write down your reflections on anything you experienced during the journey.
Welcome to the Emergence of Miracles in Living Systems.
The intersection of caring sustainability and cross-cultural shamanism. I'm Martha Brumbaugh.
And I'm Debbie Flickinger. The agenda will consist of an introduction to Martha and I. We will participate in a centering exercise. I will explain the Watson effect and caring sustainability, as well as the ability to be open to miracles.
I will talk to you about the intersection of caring sustainability and cross-cultural shamanism, and then explain my experience of the shamanic journey and how it can be used to raise consciousness. We will then do a short journey to find our wisdom tree. Afterwards, we'll close, and we encourage all of you to write down your reflections and anything you experience during the journey.
I'm Debbie Flickinger, and I teach caring sustainability within all of my work. I am an affiliated faculty at Union Institute and University, teaching courses on social justice, engaging difference, and sustainability through a caring science lens. I received my doctorate from the California Institute of Integral Studies. I've contributed a chapter in Miracles and Mysteries Witnessed by Nurses, a collection of stories edited by Gene Watson. I've also published articles about the intersectionality of consciousness and cross-cultural shamanism and facilitated workshops at various conferences around the world, most recently in Riga, Latvia.
I'm Martha Brumbaugh, and I've been practicing and teaching cross-cultural shamanism and earth-based spirituality for more than four decades. I'm a writing coach, mentoring graduate students by focusing on the juncture of writing and spirit through a cross-cultural shamanic lens. I received my doctorate in transformative learning from the California Institute of Integral Studies. I've published articles on my own lived experience of shamanic states of consciousness. I've taught at John F. Kennedy University, the Emergent Studies Institute, Healed College, and served on several dissertation committees at CIIS. I've presented workshops at CIIS, San Francisco State University, as well as many in the private sector.
Before we continue with this presentation, I would like us to center ourselves with this following exercise. Please put everything down and find the most relaxed position that you find in your chair. Close your eyes and take a deep breath to release all the stress and the tension that you may feel in your body. Let go of everything and take in another deep breath to feel the energy of Mother Earth running through your body. Now, breathe in peace. Breathe out chaos. Breathe in balance. Breathe out disparity. Breathe in harmony. Breathe out turmoil. Breathe in peace, balance, and harmony. Breathe out anything that's holding you back from the willingness to be fully present. Take time to slowly come back into our space. Energized and ready to participate. Talk about miracles in emerging systems, we mean when we are open to mystery, we can redirect our course and deepen our understanding on how the university works and the role we as individuals play a part in creating our own reality within living systems. For instance, I search for something bigger than me. I allow the mysteries of the unknown to enter in, and I stay open to possibilities in whatever shape it will take.
For me, mystery is about traveling through non-rational realities to search for answers to real-world problems and to shape my own personal reality. In his book, Peter Reason says that a living system is resilient and able to return to equilibrium following a disturbance. If we consider the destruction of forest fires, we see inevitably that it begins to grow again. The ashes create fertilizer for new plants. The animals come back and life begins again. For me, this is what miracles in living systems are all about. My shamanic practices encourage me to connect not only to the earth, but human systems as well. This is important, especially in today's world, because we've become so isolated, so dependent on technology, and we have less connection to nature. When we open up to mystery, say in the form of a shamanic journey, we can begin to open up ourselves to miracles.
I see a living system as an evolving process in which everything is interconnected in a rhythmic dance where miracles occur and possibilities are unlimited. Looking at education, for example, as a living system, during COVID-19, some educators and administrators are facing changes every day. One day schools are ordered to reopen, the next day it changes to a hybrid system, and the next day it has been decided that schools will close, and after that process, it starts all over again. The systems are forced to reevaluate, rebuild, and attempt to thrive. Truly, it will take a miracle for this living educational system to reorder itself. Gene Watson reminds us, consider this. Maybe this one moment with this one person is the very reason we're here on Earth at this time. I started working with sustainability on my doctoral journey. Everywhere I looked, I saw the connections to Watson's work. That is when the Watson effect was born. The Watson effect is a term I coined representing the web that connects knowledge and literature to Gene Watson's caring science theory. I realized that the one element missing from the academics of sustainability was caring. Caring sustainability emerged as my contribution to both transformative and consciousness studies. Caring sustainability is a caring consciousness that is the reconnection of self, others, and nature with a desired outcome of balance and harmony. As a result, it became clear to Martha and I that there is a direct connection between cross-cultural shamanic studies and my work. Years ago, Jean Watson developed 10 Caritas principles. There are 10 of them. Over the years, they have evolved into processes. Today, we will look at 4 of them that apply to our discussion. And they are open to mystery and allow miracles to enter, create a healing environment for the physical and spiritual self, which respects human dignity, be sensitive to self and others by nurturing individual beliefs and practices, develop healing, trusting, caring relationships. At the time of this recording, the United States is experiencing the COVID-19 pandemic. Unemployment is at an all-time high, and we're watching our systems crash. It's a good time to be open to miracles. Going back to the principles, processes, the second and third go together. They are interconnected. What I do in my work is I do a centering exercise that creates a container of safety. The last one also reminds me of what I do. I give my students my undivided attention as a coach and faculty member. I actively listen and repeat what I hear, which shows that I am present and that I care.
Debby and I were working on a project together when we suddenly realized how closely our work, hers on care and sustainability and mine on cross-cultural shamanic studies, were related. Both look at caring, community, and connection to the earth. All our relations, mineral, plant, water, animal, as well as humankind. Very little can survive without caring. Cross-cultural shamanism strives to reconnect the self, others, and nature. Through the shamanic journey and other ways of knowing, one is elevated to a closer relationship with higher states of consciousness. We experienced an aha moment when we discovered the intersectionality of caring sustainability and cross-cultural shamanism. Our work is connected, and for me, it demonstrates that there are many paths to the same end, the elevation of consciousness to a higher state of being. Before Angelus Arian wrote The Fourfold Way, she gave workshops in Northern California. I was introduced to these ideas in 1989. These were the guidelines that we followed for each circle. When I opened my own center, I began to call them the tenets of shamanism. Years later, I continue to start all my classes and circles with this. Show up and choose to be present. Pay attention to what has heart and meaning. Tell the truth without blame or judgment, and be open to outcome, not attached to outcome. It's important you can see how these tenets are intertwined with the 4 Caritas processes that Debby spoke of. This one was one of our aha moments. The last slide, or the last note on the slide, is a key to non-attachment. You can tell you're attached to something if you've lost your sense of humor. So pay attention to yourself. The shaman, which means healer in most indigenous cultures, is able to travel about or journey through the different worlds of reality. These could be referred to as different dimensions or states of consciousness, or even the dream time. It is within these worlds that the shaman gets information to help his community and the world. There are 4 worlds to which the shaman can journey. They're the upper world, the middle world, the lower world, and the underworld. It is in these 4 worlds that shaman encounters his teachers and allies and seeks answers to his questions. Today we'll go to the lower world, to a forest where you'll find your tree of wisdom. It's accessible anytime you need guidance. Although there are multiple ways to access our different worlds, my method is the choice of choice as the drum. And today we use a Michael Harner recording. The drum is the heartbeat that allows one to walk between worlds. It can heal our bodies and shift our consciousness. The drum is the instrument of the South and the fires of transformation. Participation is not necessary. You may just relax to the beat of the drum. Relax in your chair or on the floor. Now envision a bubble of protection around you. Send a silver cord from your solar plexus down through the floor and into the earth. See it wrapping itself around a large tree root or a boulder. Go with the beat of Michael Harner's drum. You are standing at the edge of a forest. Oops. The callback of the journey. Start walking until you find a path that will lead you into the forest. You'll recognize it. Personal wisdom tree. Follow it. moments to breathe deeply and consider what you've experienced.
Remember to honor the miracles that have emerged for you today.
Take time to reflect upon your experiences.
We invite questions and will answer them truthfully and authentically.
We've provided you with a few of the references from today.
If you would like a copy of the references, the Caritas principles, processes, and more information on cross-cultural shamanic studies, please refer to our contact information. We are full of gratitude with your presence here today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. from Erfan Kehani Halve to Science Fact as a new science. History. Professor Muhammad Ali Tahiri discovered the general idea and the basic frameworks of a qualitative and softer view of the universe based on his intuitive perceptions in 1978. This idea is opposed to a quantitative and hardware view of the universe, which lays the foundation for the softer revolution thinking. He has spent a decade examining his findings to understand the basics and the principal application of his discovery in human life. Realizing and evaluating the value of his discoveries, he decided then to present these findings, to put them into practical testing, and to utilize them in line with various scientific fields. From early 2000, Tahiri put his findings into practical use in various communities by holding home-based and private classes in the 90s. He officially introduced his viewpoints in this area by forming general classes at the public level. Tahiri named his discovery the Erfan Kehani Halve. The founder of this school was sent to prison in the early 2010 due to the ideological conflicts with the Iranian regime. And after his release earlier last year, he resumed his research activities in this field once again. The school of thought established by Tahiri has several subcategories, such as science fact. This field of science is based on Tahiri's theory, which redefines the structure of the universe comprising of consciousness, matter, and energy, in which case the consciousness is neither matter nor energy, and thus makes attempts to prove the impact of consciousness fields on human beings, animals, plants, microorganisms, cells, and molecules. Paradharmony and Symentology, complementary medicines, a software approach toward humans and software treatment of the body, the mind, and the psyche without trying any hardware intervention or manipulation. Software cognition or knowledge of existence, understanding the philosophy behind the creation and wondering where we come from. What destination are we heading to? And why and how is the creation formed, and etc. Recognition of non-organic beings, which is examining the experimental proof of the existence of non-organic beings, or in other words, living creatures with no known biologically vital organs. Tahiri Academy. What distinguishes Master Tahiri's approach from other existing mystical and philosophical schools is its empirical and testable basis of the teachings with regards to the individual and social dimensions, public health and treatment, the non-living and the living world. Therefore, here we are dealing with the repeatable experimental results for the volunteers, as well as testable findings through the experiments, both in experimental sciences and in the field of humanities. Currently, the teachings and findings of this approach are registered and published by Tahiri Academy, available at www.matahiriacademy.com. and accessible to the public at Toronto, Canada. The main topics of the courses include the consciousness world, the consciousness fields and their types, functional mechanism of the conscious field, the levels and degrees of impression of the conscious fields, quantitative and qualitative features of the consciousness fields, and the ecosystem and its governing laws and principles. According to Taheri, there are approximately millions of public researchers and practitioners of the Cosmic Consciousness Network all around the world now. These individuals are typically called announcers upon the Cosmic Consciousness Network, who facilitate such experimental research activities through their volunteer 24/7 participation, just to deliver support to different people all over the world. For the moment, the Cosmo Intel Incorporation R&D department is busy expanding its scientific research activities and findings worldwide under the direct supervision of Mr. Taheri. Cosmo Intel Limited. Cosmo Intel Limited is the main monitoring center for the consciousness fields, research and studies founded by Muhammad Ali Taheri, which organizes purely scientific researches according to his theories and teachings. The scientific and executive team in charge of this website is referred to as the R&D team, including scientists and researchers from various fields of science from all around the world. Management of the R&D team, the overall structure of the scientific process, the final supervision of the projects, and the final decision on how they are to be applied and published are all determined by Mr. Muhammad Ali Taheri himself, all through the consultations and supervision of the specialized scientific teams under his direction will have a significant impact on the professional development of this institution. Participation at the scientific and professional team is welcome based on the expertise in various areas of science. If you would like to be on board with the R&D team of the Consciousness Field Studies, please send your resume to the following email address and wait for the call. admin@cosmointel.com. Vision: registering the consciousness fields as a unique worldwide approach in the category of consciousness to perform basic and practical studies in the fields of basic sciences, humanities, medicine, and engineering. Introducing the Consciousness Fields Academic Degree in Worldwide Universities. Introducing the basics of the Consciousness Fields and the Cosmic Consciousness Network and how to interact with them. Becoming a global center for studies in the field of consciousness with the ability to experience effective and meaningful interventions in the world of science. Mission: focusing on research in various fields of basic sciences, social sciences, medicine, and engineering to obtain sufficient documentation to substantiate claims. Expanding collaboration with researchers and various centers to investigate the repeatability of data obtained through the Faraday-Amani intervention. Comparison of results obtained from the consciousness fields intervention with other approved methods in the world of science to achieve similar effects. Finally, expanding the publication of abstracts, articles, books in the world-renowned conferences, journals, and publications. A summary of the theoretical principles of Professor Taheri's teachings. The Cosmic Consciousness Network, CCN. The universe, including all its living creatures and non-living things, are under a structural and functional rich network of data or awareness, which is called the Cosmic Consciousness Network. The relation of consciousness in interaction with matter and energy. From Taheri's point of view, consciousness is neither matter nor energy. Consciousness is a non-physical factor. It's the basis of the formation and creation of the world of frequency, or energy matter. So, consciousness cannot be explained or recognized through the physical concepts, equations, and etc. But the results of applying the consciousness field can still be detected and analyzed. Based on his concept, the behavior of particles within a consciousness field is different from other fields. So the personality or the real character of the particle will be different regarding which consciousness field it is in. A particle is formable, combinable, and decomposable. Therefore, particles can be restored and repaired if in touch with a certain consciousness field. The consciousness fields. In a novel approach by Professor Tahiri, consciousness is introduced in form of specific fields with a non-matter and non-energy nature, named the consciousness fields, which bear direct consequences in the realm of both matter and energy. How to act and interact on the consciousness fields and the way to observe its impacts on the physical world all are a function to the specific laws and principles already explained and defined by Professor Tahiri. In his approach towards the theories of the consciousness fields and the cosmic consciousness network. The role of mankind in interacting with the cosmic consciousness network. The applied consciousness fields, according to Tahiri, is mediated by human mind as an announcer, by which people connect to this universal internet as a user and then receive troubleshooting and software repair programs followed by corrections and the treatment. The conscious bond of parts, mechanism and dynamics of the conscious fields in the cosmic consciousness network. According to Tahiri's theoretical principles, the general function of the consciousness fields occurs following to the conscious bond of the parts. A prerequisite for establishing a consciousness bond is the announcement process by the announcer. Details of these processes are given in the following sections. Each cell, along with the molecules and their microparticles, are made of vibrating fibers. In this theory, the factor that directs and creates these vibrations and movements is the consciousness that governs the universe or the cosmic consciousness network. For example, the Paradharmani consciousness field influence begins with the connection between the human mind and the cosmic consciousness network, and the circle or the link of consciousness bonding is established. Then, cosmic consciousness network scans and modifies all components through human mind. Interacting with the consciousness fields. Announcement and the announcer. In order to apply the Paradharmani consciousness field, a trained individual announces the connection or the link between the subject under study and the cosmic consciousness network, here named the announcement. Since during the announcement, only the relation between the subject of study and the cosmic consciousness network is called upon and no active role is given to the announcer, the term intervention does not apply. Announcers are trained and certified individuals who took and completed specific training courses taught by Mr. Muhammad Ali Tahiri and his validated trained masters. In these courses, the announcers theoretically and practically learn how to use and utilize the consciousness field and the cosmic consciousness network. Announcement is a process in which Tahari or any certified announcer declared and sent the important information of the subject under study to the cosmic conscious network by just recalling his or her name, the agreed time, and the location of the subject. The subject under study can be any patient or any individual who is willing to experience the cosmic conscious network and its functionality. Assigning the announcement. In order to assign consciousness fields for each study, researchers are required to submit an application providing a brief description of the study through the CosmoIntel website, which is www.cosmointel.com, in the Assign Announcement section. After submission of the application, any research can be done in accordance to the details of repetition and timing provided by each researcher anywhere in the world. Assessing the efficacy. In order to measure the effectiveness of the consciousness field, the desired parameters determining the effectiveness of the consciousness field have been measured by researchers unfamiliar with the consciousness field, comparatively between the sample and the control cases. Interaction with the world of science. Strategy as the first step. Apart from the theory and the functional mechanism of the introduced consciousness field, it seems that what must first be taken into account is the repetitive influence of consciousness field on the subject under the conditions of experimental research, especially in basic science. Introducing the science fact as new science. Science fact explores the category of consciousness and considers the world affected by the cosmic consciousness network. It also discovers evidence of influence on the world of matter and energy through the consciousness fields. Such evidence is known by the originator of the method as the science fact. The reason for this naming is because of its association with the world of science and the evidence that can be gained in experiments and laboratories. Science studies matter and energy. This view is generally quantitative and refers to the originality of the hardware section of the cosmos and its components. However, science fact exclusively studies the section that is neither matter nor energy and views the cosmos and its components through the software originality perspective. In fact, the world of science is seen as a tool for the emergence of science fact evidence. Diverse fields of study in science fact. Studies in the field of chemistry and physics of subatomic particles, engineering with emphasis on inorganic and organic materials and polymers. Studies in the field of cellular and molecular biology, microbiology, botany, and zoology. Studies in the field of humanities, such as psychology, basic and clinical, and sociology. Medical and clinical studies of various mental, psychological, and physical diseases. For example, we can refer to some studies that have been presented to the world of science under the science fact over the past decade. Consciousness Conference Science Fact Studies, Arizona, 2020. Currently, the latest scientific activity to present the achievements of Science Fact is the Arizona 2020 Consciousness Conference, each of which you will see briefly.